Welcome to the next episode of The Future of Trucking. And today we're doing a little bit different of a setup where I'm joined by Johannes, the founder and CEO of the RNG Coalition. And we're going to do a deep dive into what is RNG? What do we need to know about RNG? Renewable natural gas. It's this thing that is extremely prevalent but isn't often spoken about. So Johannes, thanks for joining us today. And we're excited to have you on.
Thomas, my friend, thank you again for the invitation. It is a treat and a pleasure to join you on your podcast. Renewable natural gas, as you know, is really a no-regret solution. There's certainly strong political preferences for different biofuels, and each sector has their own advocate and interest. And I really think to achieve energy independence and security and to really secure resilience as a country, we have to really embrace a truly diverse energy portfolio. And we've never suggested that renewable natural gas alone is a single source solution to address all of our climate change or renewable energy objectives or energy independence and security aspirations, but it's a critical component of that. And the beautiful thing about where RNG comes from, Thomas, which really connects with most people, is it's coming from the organic waste streams that every single household in our society is responsible for producing, right? I use the example every week in our house, Thursday night. It used to be me, now my children push our green waste, blue recycling, and black trash bins out to the curb. And for most folks, the waste that we're producing as households is out of sight, out of mind. But as companies like Waste Management, Republic Services, and others pick up and mitigate and collect and manage and recycle the waste that we're producing, a life cycle is really just beginning. And whether that refuse gets distributed to landfill or to digesters, wherever recycling facilities, where that the food waste is separated out from the landfill, that organic material inevitably breaks down naturally. And as it decomposes, it emits methane. So what our industry does is we step in and we capture that methane and we prevent what would otherwise be inevitable and very harmful fugitive emissions. We know that methane is a short-lived climate pollutant, many times more potent than carbon as a greenhouse gas. And we take it a step further. Rather than just mitigating the harm, we actually convert what is an environmental liability into a renewable energy asset. And that renewable natural gas can be compressed or liquefied to be used as a renewable form of CNG or LNG to fuel medium and heavy duty vehicles. It's also used to produce renewable electricity and renewable heat. And very proud of the work that our industry has done and the service that we provide in terms of providing heat power to fuel and power vehicles, homes, commerce, and industry around the continent.
So what I found is like what most people don't understand is that molecularly, this is the same, right? Whether it's natural gas or renewable natural gas, you know, if you're a chemist, you're looking at the same stuff. It's just it's coming from different sources, right? Normal natural gas is being fracked versus renewable natural gas is, you know, the way I try to describe it to people is it's basically you're capturing what would have been pollution, able to take that, pump it into the pipelines and use that to actually fuel these vehicles, or as you expressed, use it for a lot of other things as well. And then, you know, normally where the conversation goes next is people ask, well, what is this, like 1 or 2% of the fuel that's out there, right? I mean, most people think this is like a science experiment, but can you maybe share a little bit more on like where we're actually at as an industry? How much of the fuel sold at stations is already coming from RNG, and where do you see it heading as well?
Yeah, well, it depends. If you look at states where policy promulgated programs are in place that incent or support the proliferation of biofuels like renewable natural gas and biogas for various applications, you're going to see a greater uptick in use of RNG. So you look at states like California that have programs like that, like renewable portfolio standard programs that have incentivized electricity from renewable resources for decades now, and you're going to see a greater use of our commodity in states like that. So we're trying to replicate those policy programs across the country in multiple states as well as at the federal level. But to your question in terms of how much RNG is being used, for example, in transportation fuel today, if you look at California, it's virtually 100% of all natural gas engines on the road in California today are fueled by renewable natural gas. And the real benefit to the environment is the emissions reductions. It's a decarbonization of the fuel that's dispensed in and deployed in vehicles that are transporting goods and commerce across the state and interstate. We're proud of that. If you look nationwide, where there isn't a national low carbon fuel standard, at least not yet, that's certainly a possibility in the future, but there is a renewable fuel standard or the RFS program While it doesn't target decarbonization of fuel, it incents and requires obligated parties to account for, produce, or support renewable fuel production. And so at the federal level, it's closer to 70%, right? So there's still significant more margin there for RNG to replace other fuels like diesel in the medium and heavy duty space and power natural gas engines there. We're making progress, but we're certainly mindful as an organization, always trying to look past the immediate and attractive opportunities in the present to future realities, trying to predict patterns and trying to prep our industry and our membership for those future realities. And that's a real question that comes to mind, for example, Thomas, is look, whether it's 3, 5, 7, 12 years down the road, at some point, given how fast our industry has scaled over the last 12 years, RNG production is going to exceed demand from the medium and heavy duty transportation fuel space based on the number of natural gas vehicles that are on the road today. And so I think that creates opportunities for other markets, but within the transportation sector, I think that creates opportunities for other technologies as well, which again, why we enjoy such a great partnership and are grateful for Hyliion's membership support of our mission. But would love to kind of get your thoughts on how that might benefit Hyliion in that future market reality.
Yeah, so my view is more and more RNG production and capturing of methane is great for everyone, right? Because, you know, what's ultimately, when it gets to, you know, being used in a vehicle to charge up the batteries, the pollution levels are so much less than if that had just gassed off as methane. So what our goal is, you know, we, in an ideal world, is we're deploying more and more vehicles out there that are electric, but use nat gas or renewable natural gas to charge the batteries. If that RNG production is increasing as well, and we can kind of scale at similar levels so that we're moving people off of diesel fuel, moving them into an electric powertrain that leverages RNG, and then the production of RNG is rising at the same levels as we're deploying vehicles, that's a huge win-win, right? Because then for fleets, they can be guaranteeing that the fuel that's going into their vehicle is RNG, right? And for a lot of these companies that have ESG benefits, or they've made a statement of by 2040, we want to be net carbon zero, or we want to get to net carbon negative in the years and years ahead. RNG is the way to do that, right? And even, you know, most people don't realize when someone talks about net carbon negative electricity or net carbon negative hydrogen even, the reality is that the way they're getting that in almost all instances is by using RNG, right? So what our belief is don't go through the process of taking what is great RNG and then converting it into hydrogen or converting it into electricity then to go into a charger to charge the vehicle. You're much better off just taking that great RNG, putting it directly in the truck and using that to drive the vehicle to charge up the battery packs. You know, don't go through the efficiency losses of making it into hydrogen. At least that's our view. So our whole goal is, as you know, you make this push towards producing more RNG, we'll make the push towards getting more vehicles out there that are going to consume that RNG. And maybe that kind of is a nice segue into, well, what are some of the numbers behind that? And from the reports that I've seen coming out most recently, at least what I'm gathering from it is, you know, we have a certain number of RNG capturing facilities or production facilities out there, but it looks like there are just as many new RNG capturing facilities that are either in construction or being permitted right now as there are in existence. So I'm curious, kind of, what do you see this landscape of being? Have you talked about California is already at 100% or just about there? The, you know, nationwide we're at like 70%. If we didn't even add any more natural gas vehicles, which for Hyliion's benefit, I think we are going to, right? But what do you see in terms of when that would happen? Of, you know, 100% across the country, it's all RNG for vehicles.
That's a great question. When we did coalesce the space in 2011, there were only 31 operating RNG facilities in all of North America. So if you do the quick math, right, over three decades, only 31 facilities were developed. That's an average of about one per year. So we knew that had to change given the value proposition that our industry represents and that each facility represents, both for the environment as well as for the economy. So by 2015, we had quadrupled that three-decade annual project development average from one to four, and we had 47 operating facilities. So we challenged our industry at our end-of-year conference to double the number of operating facilities by 2025. So our goal was 100 facilities, and very proud to say that, you know, in spite of the initial sort of like, that's awful aggressive, you know, it took 30 years to build 30 and you want to build 53 more in the next 10. We did that. And again, policy, effective policy advocacy, public education helped pave the way by creating market demand for the industry product that allowed developers to go out and obtain the necessary capital to put shovels in the ground and materialize our mission. And we're proud of that. We brought project number 100 online in July of 2019, 5.5 years ahead of schedule. So we knew it could be done. And just before COVID sort of shut the rest of the world down, at our December 2019 conference, we had the opportunity to come back to our industry leadership and challenge them once more with what ultimately became our sustainable methane abatement recycling timeline, or SMART. SMART is something that we announced in December of 2019. We set a benchmark for 2025 of 500 facilities. To your question, as I acknowledged earlier, we have 279 RNG facilities in operation today. We have another 176 that are under construction and another 284 that are already in development. That means they've already got some level of permitting passed or equipment ordered. And so, I mean, you do the math and that's over 600, almost over 700 projects that we expect to be online in the next 18, 24 months.
If someone wants to know more, if someone wants to learn, you know, even more than what we spoke about today on RNG, where would you direct them? Where can they go find more information?
I would, if I may, promote our website, which is rngcoalition.com. There's a treasure trove and just an abundance of information that we make publicly available. Again, we have policy advocacy and education information that we prepare and we deliver to advance our mission on behalf of our members. But there is just as much information that we're making available and accessible to the general public because we want everyone to know what we're doing. Our goal is to, in the near term, when people think of renewable energy, we want renewable natural gas to be included in the top three with the other intermittent forms of energy that come top of mind for most folks. So we're working on that. We got a long way to go. And more specifically, in addition to the About Us page, I would direct them to the education page where you can click on several drop-down menus and access white papers and reports and studies and maps and databases to learn more about. And should you have a desire to support us in our mission, there's various ways you can do that too. And again, that information's available at rngcoalition.com.
Well, Johannes, I appreciate you taking the time to kind of give this deep dive, give this overview on what's going on in the RNG world. And hopefully in the next, you know, years and in decades ahead here, RNG becomes this primary fuel source that not only is being used in vehicles, but being used in other applications as well. And, you know, both of our companies will keep pushing this along, keep making the mission happen. So thank you for joining us. Appreciate you taking the time and we'll chat soon.
Thank you so much, Thomas. Again, grateful to you for the invitation, for the opportunity to, again, share what you and I are up to with your audience and make the case for renewable natural gas. I'm convinced that nothing is bought, everything is sold. And things are only sold once a compelling story is told. I love getting to tell our story. So again, thank you for the chance to share it with your audience. And thank you for Hyliion's membership support. We look forward to continued collaboration for years and years ahead.
Sounds great. Thanks again.
Thank you, Thomas.